Hello, everybody. Welcome. Welcome to a special event here at UW-Milwaukee. I want to thank UW-Milwaukee and all the special help we received in setting this up. So let's hear for the staff who helped put this together. I'm Jeff Maris from WisPolitics.com. We do events with UW-Milwaukee. We do six a year at various locations, and we're doing a special one tonight at a special time because it's a special topic. So I want to thank UW-Milwaukee, of course, Medical College of Wisconsin, the Milwaukee Police Association, 1125 of Pabst, and the firm Consulting for sponsoring this event series. And I want to introduce our panelists. Charles Benson is a panelist, but he's on the news, so he'll be here shortly. We're going to cut him a break since he's actually working. Now I want to introduce our panel going down the list here. Dan O'Donnell, he's at WISN Radio, where he has his own show, conservative talk show, and he's a former newsman and anchor, and a non-practicing lawyer, I learned from your bio.
Don't hold that against me.
Okay. And then we have Paul Maslin, a good friend of mine. He's a Democratic pollster based in Madison, does worldwide research through FM3 Research. He's a pollster, and so don't hold that against him.
Right.
And then we have UWM political science professor Kathleen Dolan. So please welcome our panelists. So we will have some questions from the audience, but I'm going to start off by just asking the panel some questions. And please be nice out there, and no hooting and hollering. Let's hear from the panelists on this question. And I'll just start with you, Professor Dolan. So the inauguration was Friday. There's President Trump. And what did you like? What didn't you like in terms of maybe the messages to Wisconsin and the electorate? Speak directly into that mic.
Well, as a political scientist who studies elections and voting in the United States, I think that the thing that I've liked the most in the last week has been the engagement. Excuse me. You know, we've seen different versions of engagement this week. We saw the inauguration, and we saw people who were supportive of President Trump. And then the next day, we saw engagement of people who may be opposed to him. And as I try to tell my students all the time, you know, wherever you are on the spectrum, what is most important is the participation. So the differences that this election has shown us are things that we have to sort of struggle with as a political society. But I think that one of the most successful things we've seen is that there seems to be some awakening of people's understanding that they do have to be actively engaged in their government and in the political system if things are going to serve the needs of the greatest number of people.
Okay, Paul.
Well, what I liked is very simple. Two words, alternative facts. If George Orwell had a sense of humor, he'd be laughing right now, I think. Maybe he did, I don't know. Maybe there's an Orwellian scholar out there somewhere. But, you know, long after the dispute over the inaugural crowd size or now, I guess, whether people voted legally or not in the election, and who knows what it's going to be tomorrow or 3 days from now, I do think that it is a, you know, as a partisan, I'm glad that when I hear alternative facts being said on sports talk shows as well as late night comedies, I realize that it's reached some kind of critical mass with the American people. And it does set up, I think, one piece of what ultimately may be a reaction to all this, which is there a fundamental trust problem here? And I will just illustrate that. I was saying to folks beforehand that Edelman just came out with a barometer of worldwide trust of the public. This is not just the U.S., this is the entire world of institutions from governmental to business to media, et cetera, and it's by far at the lowest point it's ever been. That's obviously one of the things that fueled Trump's election, but if you start your administration with that kind of credibility problem, and it's already become that much in sort of invested into the public, and it strikes me, by the way, when you're just a quick, having seen executive offices and administrations before, you know, you start thinking about who are the key players here and what's their interest. And one of the sagas of what happens with Trump will be not only what he does, but what his administration does to try to shape this administration, and what essentially the various parameters are and the interests are. Who in this administration cares about the man? Well, it's probably Jared Kushner, to be honest. I'm not sure how many other people do that are really close to him. So you got that. Who in there in this administration cares about the mission and the message? And clearly, Steve Bannon is probably the one occupying that chair. Who in this administration cares about the party? Because after all, they have a Republican majority now, and it's going to be up for grabs in 2018. My side's going to try to fight back. Well, you know, you think Reince Priebus is probably that person. Who in this administration cares about the country? Well, we all hope it's people like Mattis and Flynn and Pompeo, you know, occupying the key national security positions, and they're going to be the ones looking out for the national interest in what will undoubtedly be very storm-infested waters. And who in this administration is looking out for themselves? And I'm sorry, Kellyanne, you're going to win that one going away. She's done very well, thank you. To the flip side of your question, Jeff, the thing that bothers me, actually, as a Democrat, was actually Trump's speech, and not for the reasons you might think. It bothers me because I think it was an effective speech, exactly for what he needs to do. This was not a speech. We all in the media and everybody else can complain about. He didn't reach out, and what about the people that didn't vote for him? And in some ways, he probably did inspire even bigger crowds for those demonstrations on Saturday with his rhetoric on Friday, but he doubled down. He knows who got him there. He knows the message that's there. I can talk till the sun goes down about the difficulties of actually producing results. You know, he had to go talk to Arnold Schwarzenegger, his successor in Celebrity Apprentice. Just think about the whole thing. By the way, isn't this just beyond bizarre? I mean, if you just step back and just tried to become like, I'm John F. Kennedy looking, or Ronald Reagan looking down on all this, what happened to America that this reality, whatever, what is a reality show? A reality show helped launch a guy to the presidency, and the guy that took over is a guy that was a bodybuilder who was actually governor of California, and he is now, and Trump is still, and what, you've got to be kidding. But, to get back to the point, that speech was a Trumpian speech. I mean, he, listen and give him credit. He had some big hands, I guess is the way to say it, because there's Obama sitting there and he's talking about carnage. And you and I and everybody can say, well, the numbers really don't show that, but he doesn't care about the numbers. He's caring about the attitudes, and I'm sure Dan will chime in here, but I mean, it was clearly an effective speech. And my last thing I'll say is, oh boy, new administration comes in, new executive, controversial, riles people up. There's marches, there's crowds, there's protests, there's amazing counter-reaction. There's people saying he's not legitimate. Scott Walker is still governor 6 years later. We in Wisconsin have seen this movie before. There's no guarantee that just, I think it's wonderful that there was engagement. My partner called me on Saturday afternoon and said, this is my business partner, he said, are you surprised? And I said, John, if you'd called me yesterday, I would have been. But between yesterday and today, I found out that a dear friend of mine in Sacramento was marching, that both of my sisters in Oregon and Colorado were marching, that my niece was marching, that everybody I knew who's female over the age of 18 years old was marching. So no, I'm not surprised. But marching and actually winning and winning back the country are two different things. And on that note,
well, I'm sorry, Paul, that you weren't ready for that question. Okay. All right. Dan, fire away.
Well, unfortunately, folks, that's all the time we have for this evening. Thank you all for showing up. Paul is absolutely correct. What I've loved the most about the last 5 days is, well, hell, it hasn't been boring, has it? People are so engaged, to Kathleen's point, and they're marching in the streets or they're showing up in obviously record numbers for Donald Trump's inauguration. This, I mean, the crowd sizes were huge, the hugest.
10,000 out there right now.
20,000, that's an alternative fact.
In the cafeteria, they're listening.
Look, I'm in the talk radio business, which isn't in the specific partisanship business, it's in the entertainment business. So I understand that, yes, I am going to be discussing a particular conservative agenda, but also my job is to get people to listen to me. Donald Trump is a consummate entertainer, and like Ronald Reagan, a generation before him, who was derisively called the great communicator, he was able to effectively use words in a little bit more flowery of a style than Donald Trump did in his inaugural address, but to convey the same sense that there is a large group of people that have felt disaffected, rightly or wrongly, over the last not just 8 years, but for the last really 15, 20 years. They feel like the global economy has sort of left them behind. And we're not just seeing that in the United States. We're seeing it across the globe with the Brexit vote just a couple of months before Trump's election. That should have been a big red flag to the Clinton campaign and to everybody who said Trump doesn't have a chance. Well, the British people thought there would never be a chance that they'd leave the European Union until they did. It's the same mentality at play there. What I liked over the last 5 days is not just has it been entertaining, but as Kathleen said, it has brought out, I think, what's really sort of laid dormant since the battles over Act 10 here in Wisconsin. You had people, how many thousand did we get? I'm no crowd scientist, which I learned over the weekend is a thing. You can have crowd scientists estimate your, yeah, what was it, like 20,000?
There were times we hit more like 50 or
50?
75 was the biggest.
That's an alternative fact, all right? 50,000, 50, 60,000. You had all of these people, 70,000, do I hear 80, 90,000. There were a lot of people that were getting out there and marching. The last time we did see that, Paul's absolutely correct, was Act 10. What's going to be interesting to note, though, like with Act 10, I think what happened was is the protesters and their enthusiasm, I'll put it politely, overshadowed the message of the resistance to the Walker administration, the Democrat Party. So what the Republicans were able to do is say, look, this is the opposition right here. And I think with every march, with every vulgar sign that you're seeing, you know, that gets replayed over and over again, it could potentially be counterproductive. Scott Walker survived a recall election. He won his 2014 reelection bid by an even bigger margin. And I think a lot of that was because, and look, the Wisconsin Democrat Party, I'm sorry, Paul, is not in great shape right now. And I think a lot of problems with that are because the lessons from Act 10 were that if you overplay your hand and you're marching in the streets instead of focusing your attention on actual intelligent messaging, you're going to lose at the ballot box and you're going to lose in the war of public opinion.
Okay, Kathleen, you want to chime in here?
Well, I just want to draw comparisons between what happened in Wisconsin during Act 10 and what's happened nationally, and you could argue, you know, as Dan has done, you know, that there was one set of explanations, but I think the other set of explanations is that the cases are very similar, in that we had leaders who were willing to focus on certain issues in their politics, perhaps find scapegoats, perhaps make the dialogue about less about information and less about reality and much more about playing to people's emotions. And we know that people are emotional first and intellectual second, but that's a very successful tool that politicians use. So if you look at how Act 10 played out here in Wisconsin and how the elections played out, that was in part about, you know, scapegoating public employees, scapegoating the university system, making people believe that things in Wisconsin were much worse than maybe they were from an objective sense. And people could argue that much of the same thing has happened during the Trump campaign. So I think there are multiple explanations for any election in the United States. I think we could look at individual candidate level explanations. We could look at economic explanations. We could look at all sorts of different things. But I think what's interesting is that both of these elections show us that we are in a particular place with regard to American politics and with regard to our dialogue and with regard to our respect for facts versus alternative facts, whatever it is. And I think that those two things are similar. I mean, the Wisconsin case study could have been a good message, you know, a good object lesson for the Democratic Party, because it was in many ways sort of a miniature first run of what we saw in 2016.
Okay, so let... from what you said, let's talk about polarization. So after the recall, Wisconsin becomes polarized. And it seems like after this 2016 election, the nation is polarized, maybe more polarized than ever. We seem to say that after every election, but boy, you know, it really seems to be true now. So are we as polarized, we as a country, as polarized as it looks? Or are there what?
We are.
Okay.
And my side won more votes, but we didn't win the election. No matter what Trump says, we won more votes. But we didn't win them in the right places. And the interesting story about Wisconsin, let me just say, we can go in any number of directions here. One of the things is that we didn't have, the irony is, of course, Obamacare is one of the things that got Walker where he was. And obviously, it was still existing as an issue that was used against Democrats 6 years later. Well, guess what, folks? When premiums go up and people start losing insurance, even though Trump vows that everyone's going to be insured and it's going to be cheaper, and Harry Houdini was from Wisconsin, I don't think he could have pulled that trick off. When real outcomes happen in a way that's very different than the Act 10 debate and the debate over public employee unions, because of whatever damage was happening to teachers or schools or you know, was more in a political context and through a prism and wasn't as real, when that happens, when the job delivery that has been promised to people in places like northern and central western Wisconsin and upper Michigan and the states that Trump knows elected him, there's going to be some real outcome. Now, let me just say parenthetically, because I think Donald Trump, after all, has a history. And his history is in business, and his history involves money, and his history involves favoritism with politicians and New York City, kind of the way the world works. He's already said, I mean, I've warned people in California, we do a lot of our business in California, who've said, well, you know, what happens if we've got a lot of people here and he's going to be upset if, you know, he loses the market in California and he can't get people insured or this. And I've basically stopped them and said, I don't think he cares one bit about what happens in California. He has already advertised the fact. He said, you know, I won. Those people in Wisconsin and in Ohio and in Pennsylvania and Florida, obviously, they're the ones who elected me. I expect that you're going to see in this new era of reform and drain the swamp the most pork-laden, specific jobs, money, projects going to these states that we've ever seen before. Because, he, you know, I don't know what the overall story is going to be, but he knows that he's got to reward these folks or he's in danger. And to go to the polarization question, there's no question the polarization in Wisconsin exists, and we all live it, between about 90 miles. Right? There is Madison, and there is the city of Milwaukee, and then there is the Wow counties and the counties in between. And the polarization is, as my friend Craig Gilbert in the Journal Sentinel did a large set of stories about a couple of years ago, is as intense as anywhere in the country. And now the rest of the country is moving in that direction. But I will maintain until my dying day that the voters that swung this election, the swinging gate of Wisconsin politics, and it turned out that gate swung from about North Dakota to Maine. It was the entire upper tier of the country that moved dramatically towards Trump in those rural and small town areas. That gate could just as easily swing back because, once again, an administration and a group of politicians and a specific president and leader disappointed them. Walker didn't happen. He was able to keep it under control and so far, at least, survive. But that is not polarization. That is still essentially frustration, anger, cynicism, distrust, and it all culminated in a vote against the Democratic nominee, Hillary Clinton, and for Donald Trump this time. But those votes could go anywhere.
Okay, don't worry. Charles Benson from WTMJ is here, so you'll get your say in a bit, Charles. But the question is, are we as polarized as it looks? Go ahead, Dan.
Yeah, we are. Absolutely. I mean, I could point you to poll after poll after poll that shows that Republicans have gone more conservative really over the last 15 years. You could probably trace it back to 9/11 or even before that. Democrats have gone far to the left. I would posit another reason that Democrats lost not just the presidency, but pretty much everywhere except California. And except the East Coast was that they have gone too far to the left and lost basically everywhere else. In fact, you can point to the Hillary Clinton win in the popular vote. 2.8 million votes, that's 100% California. In fact, if you want to go even more specific, that's probably a little more than two cities. It's Los Angeles and San Francisco, the Oakland Bay Area. All right? So, yeah, we're polarized, but I don't think any more so than in our nation's history. We have been so polarized that we went to war with each other after Abraham Lincoln was elected. We were so polarized that, hey, the most popular play is about a guy getting murdered in a duel because of a political slight.
That wasn't a good play, though, remember.
Very overrated.
Overrated.
Sad.
Overrated.
Although if anybody's got tickets, I'll take them off your hands since it's so terrible. I think this is just how politics are. And it goes to the fundamental question, are we more polarized now, or does just everybody have a voice that everybody else can hear? I mean, this is the first generation where literally anybody in this room can have their own microphone. You don't need to be on television or in a classroom or on the radio. You've got a Twitter feed, you've got a Facebook feed, and just like that, what you say can be heard around the world. So it's great that the democratic process exists to essentially involving everybody in political discourse, but at the same time, you get extreme voices that pop up, sorry about that, and will be used by the other side to show, okay, this is representative of, say, everybody on the right, the Nazi guy who just got punched, Richard Spencer. Already you're saying, well, this is Trump's base. I saw something on Facebook, coincidentally enough, a woman right after the election of Trump, you voted for the same person that the KKK did. Does that make you feel good? Well, wait a second. Because somebody voted for someone that 49, 50 million other Americans did, they're no better than the KKK? What kind of nonsense is that? We're polarized, yes, but our differences aren't nearly as extreme as I think they're often made out to be for political gain, and quite frankly, I'll turn the mirror back on myself for ratings in the media as well. I mean, there are still issues that all unite us. I mean, there are still things that all of us as Americans, as human beings, can agree on, and that is the Packers should have been in the Super Bowl. You see, I mean, there's always the ability to find common ground if we're looking for it. And, you know, things like this, an election, an inauguration, it kind of brings out two opposing sides. But what we have to remember is the overwhelming majority of people are somewhere in the middle.
Okay, so Kathleen and then Charles.
Yeah, so as a political scientist, just a couple of things I would like to say. First of all, we need to retire the notion that if California didn't vote, then it would have been just as equal, because California gets to vote. I mean, we could take that is something that we hear conservatives saying in this election, is if only California hadn't voted, you know, he would have won the popular vote as well.
They want to go back to the three-fifths days back in the, you know, well, pre-slavery.
I mean, we could just take any number of red states and combine them and say, look, there are 3 million votes there, and she would have won by 6 million votes if we didn't allow the Great Plains states to vote. So that's a sort of
I don't think anybody was actually saying that California shouldn't be allowed to vote.
You're going there.
Has anyone said that this is like the three-fifths compromise.
You're
I know
going
you're
there.
Joking.
You're
but
going there.
Well, I mean, what I'm suggesting
I
is
am?
We can't
no,
deal
with
oh, okay.
you.
Oh,
yeah.
What I'm suggesting is that we should not delegitimize the popular vote. We should not delegitimize. It happens to be the phrase that is often used by some people who are more conservative, but it just, I'm not suggesting you're saying Californians can't vote. What I'm saying is we need to let go of this notion that we can delegitimize the popular vote because it occurred. The second point is with regard to polarization, I mean, both Paul and Dan have focused more on sort of how we are at kind of top level emotions. But the other thing that we have to remember is that there are structural aspects of our system that have created the outcomes that we have had. The Electoral College, right, is something that every 4 years people say, what the hell is that? And, you know, I teach Introduction to American Government very often, and, you know, young people have no idea what the heck it is, and, you know, how are we electing a president? But we have structures in place that give us the outcomes. We feed into those outcomes, but they express the outcomes through these structures. The other thing is gerrymandering. I mean, we're polarized in part because our gerrymandering here in Wisconsin, certainly, and at other places at the congressional level around the country, have given us, you know, where we are with regard to elections right now. So you could suggest that the Democrats may be in a weakened position in Wisconsin, and that's true, but gerrymandering is really hard to fight back against. And so there are structural things in places that winners get the spoils, and that's what American politics is about. Elections have consequences. And so it's not something that, no matter how, you know, we are divided as a people, it's not just that, right? We have to remember that we're working inside a system of structures and processes that often help determine our outcomes.
Okay, Charles, welcome. You get an easy question. Are we as polarized as we think we are?
Well, it's an interesting question, and one that what makes covering politics in Wisconsin so interesting is that, are we a red state or are we a blue state? And I think when you look at the results of this year's election in 2016, it changed the course of history of what we have seen in the past. I started covering Wisconsin politics in 1986, but I'm going to go back to 1984, the presidential election. The last time a Republican won in Wisconsin was in 1984. If you go from 84 to 2016, 7 of those 9 presidential elections in Wisconsin went to the Democrats. Starting in 1986, if you look at the governor race, 7 out of 9 of those races go to the Republican. Pretty remarkable. And I've included the 2012 recall. Walker wins in 2012 in the same state that Obama wins just a few months later. Pretty remarkable. So are we polarized? Yeah. Why does it happen? Why do more voters, because what usually the trend is that in presidential election, more voters come out and that helps the Democrats. So when I look at what happened this time around, why did Trump buck the trend? Why did Ron Johnson buck the trend? And I think the storyline there is pretty fascinating because Ron Johnson, by all accounts, was not supposed to win, either historically or in the early polling. I mean, it got close at the very end. And I believe Ron Johnson got more votes than Donald Trump statewide by like 75,000. So again, things changed this time around. You can talk about voter turnout, the suppressed vote, or whatever you want. But this state has always looked blue and red. And for a guy who covers politics, it makes it pretty fascinating.
Okay, let's last question from me before we go to the audience. Okay, so the theme of this is how will the Republican domination of Washington, D.C., both in the Congress and the Trump White House, what will be the effect, you know, just maybe what's the major effect, or what effect do you see really impacting Wisconsin? It could be a political effect or a policy effect. Let's just start, let's start with you, Dan, this time.
In the short term, the biggest thing you're going to see is the deregulation. I mean, we saw this morning, actually, Trump restarted the, at least took the first steps to restarting the Dakota Access Pipeline, Keystone XL Pipeline. There's a real concerted effort. There was some environmental deregulation or an executive order aimed at relaxing some of the environmental regulations. I think the thing that we're going to see first is that there is going to be less bureaucratic red tape, especially for construction starts and things like that, that ideally, at least what the Trump administration has signaled that it wants to do is get things moving much, much quicker. The problem with Washington, as anybody who's ever dealt with the federal government at all, is things move very, very slowly. What we're going to see, though, is, and Trump has also signaled that there's going to be reduction in federal regulation by 75%. I have not actually heard what that means specifically, like reducing total regulations by 75% impact. I It's 75%. That's the line they're going with. The emphasis is going to be on deregulation and a promotion of the private sector without government interference. That seems to be what at least the first 100 days is going to be about, from the Obamacare repeal to the environmental regulations being relaxed. For goodness sakes, the pick to lead the EPA was a guy who sued the EPA as Attorney General of, I believe it was Oklahoma. And I think that's really going to be what we see quickest, because the reality is that it takes a while for you and me here in Wisconsin to notice what is coming from Washington. The dirty little secret is that although we talk most often about what goes on in Washington, it's what goes on in Madison and what goes on in Milwaukee and our local governments that affect us most directly and that really impact our lives most greatly. So to answer your question, what are we going to see quickest from Trump? What are we going to, what have we seen so far? Meh, not much.
Okay, what's the biggest effect on GOP domination of D.C., Paul?
I just got to throw one thing in here first, since he mentioned the EPA guy. You know, the Saturday Night Live has been off on a number of things and not always quite right, but man, when they had Bryan Cranston doing Walter White as head of the DEA, they nailed it. They nailed it. I would say two things, Jeff. One is what I alluded to earlier. There's going to be real bread and butter economic specific outcomes for people, healthcare and the economy in particular, over these next 2 years, over the 4 years. And it's going to play out nationally, but obviously each state is going to have its own little piece of the story here. And he's talking tough on trade. We'll see. I mean, what if China outflanks us somehow and calls some of the banknotes or does some things that can upset our economy and all of a sudden Trump doesn't look so smart? What if the Republican attempt to both repeal and replace Obamacare founders and the market goes nuts in terms of both premiums and people losing their insurance at least for a while? I mean, we don't know where it's all heading. So the one thing is I would just say they're bread and butter outcomes that are going to affect Wisconsin and the entire country, but certainly no different than here. And that classic middle class, small town, small city, northern Wisconsin voter, I think, is in the crosshairs in terms of the outcome. The second thing is fascinating, which is Scott Walker. Just forget for a second that there was no Donald Trump. Not easy to do. Walker would be heading toward a third term. He'd be at a point where, and I'll be honest, it doesn't look yet like we have a strong Democratic opponent that's emerged, but, we'll see. But he would be at a classic point where, frankly, any incumbent, no matter who they are, Republicans, Democrats, anywhere in any kind of a medium to large size state, people start wondering, are they running out of gas? Are they running out of steam? What would 12 years get us? What starts happening here? It was one thing to have him go through the recall, which is probably a tactical mistake on our part. It happened. And another thing to have him get reelected. Dan's absolutely correct. He actually won by more in 2014 than he did in 2010. But it's not so automatic that you just get a third turn. You get it handed to you. But the big but is, I wonder if Walker, at least for now, I mean, you're right. Ultimately, it's the decisions that made in Madison that have a more direct impact on a lot of people's lives. But we have a media person here who's going to, I think, probably agree with me. Right now, the entire story is Trump. And by the way, there's a big Wisconsin piece of that with the chief of staff and the speaker. Will Trump and all the Trumpism supersede Walker in a way? And I don't know if that's good or bad for him, frankly. But is that the big dynamic? And let's not kid ourselves. These elections now, I was talking to somebody about this yesterday, and we said, really, it's going back almost to the 90s that we have had a series of increasingly nationalized elections where, we think all politics is local, or each state or each campaign has its own peculiarities and they play out. And sometimes that's true. But we've had tremendous swings back and forth for big time national reasons. And that may be the biggest thing that happens here, and it may affect the governor.
Okay, Professor. Oh,
real quick, just to add to that, what's going to happen if what typically happens in the first midterm election after a new president is elected, his party typically gets shellacked.
Yep.
All right, will that have a ripple impact on what Republicans are looking at? They're looking at the Tammy Baldwin seat as one of the most vulnerable in the entire country. You've also got Governor Walker. Typically, Tommy Thompson was bucking a huge trend and winning a third term. That doesn't happen very often. If Democrats can find a candidate, I mean, will the Trump effect and will just the natural political cycle effect impact Walker? That's going to be really interesting to see.
Okay, Professor Dolan, what's the biggest impact on GOP-dominated D.C. on Wisconsin, do you think?
Well, I mean, I think, as Paul was suggesting, you know, at this point, the real true answer is we don't know, because so little of what he's put forward has any real shape behind it, so we don't know what those specifics are. But there are about 250,000 people in Wisconsin who get their health care under the Affordable Care Act, and so as repeal and replace happens, whether it is the markets collapsing and the exchanges collapsing because of the unknown or because there is really a replacement, that will affect the lives of 250,000 Wisconsinites. There are 55,000 Wisconsinites who are federal government employees who yesterday had their salaries frozen and may or may not face cuts. So there are, you know, living, breathing people on the ground, right, who we know. We don't know exactly what's going to happen, but we know what's going to happen. Tariffs and trade, we don't know what that's going to do to the agricultural sector in Wisconsin or the manufacturing, you know, whether different trade deals are changed, whether tariffs are slapped on manufacturers. So there are things that, you know, sound great, and then when we find out what the details are, we'll be able to have a better sense of what the impact is. I do think, as Dan suggests, one of the single biggest things we're going to see is a change in regulation and a move at the congressional level to move a lot of the federal laws that send money to the states to what we call a block grant system, where the states get large pots of money and then they are largely free to spend them as they choose. We're going to get different interpretations of things. The Obama Department of Justice told Governor Walker that his plan to drug test people who get food assistance was unconstitutional. The Department of Justice under Attorney General Jeff Sessions, if he is confirmed, may come to a different decision on that. So it is about interpretation, right? I mean, as I've said already, elections have consequences, and the biggest thing in the executive branch is the ability to interpret the laws. And so as we get more detail, we'll know more, but those are some areas of life that will no doubt be affected.
Okay, Charles Benson, WTMJ.
So Garth Brooks wrote a book, Friends in Low Places. He could write one about Wisconsin politicians, Friends in High Places, because when you look at the Wisconsin alliance that has come out of this election, I think Mike Pence and Scott Walker are pretty darn close. I think Walker will have a direct line, to Mike Pence. They think alike, they talk a lot. Pence picked Walker to be his VP debate partner. So I think there's a close relationship there. Pence comes out of Congress, he is a former governor. They will work together to try to move Scott Walker's agenda forward. And what I mean about that is states, even under Tommy Thompson, like to be the first in trying out new things, as we saw with school choice and welfare reform. I think Walker is going to try to use that as a way to try to get things done that he thinks he can't or couldn't get done before. You mentioned one of them already. You can't ignore the Paul Ryan, the Reince Priebus connection. The two of them will do the same dance. They think alike. They're more conservative. What's going to be interesting about that relationship is that I don't think at this point that Paul Ryan is really close to Donald Trump. Reince Priebus is going to be that guy that works between the two of them to try to work out a plan to whatever it is they want to get through the House. There's going to be a lot of things that's going to be easy for them in terms of job creation, regulation, taxes. But when you start getting at some of the other big issues, Paul Ryan, not a big entitlement guy, so will there be changes on that front? And we already saw some of that at work. You know, I think before the House even got to business, they changed something on the ethics rules, and Trump pounced on that, and there was some indication, you know, that all comes out of that connection between Paul Ryan and Reince Priebus. At the state level, Robin Voss, the Assembly Speaker, and Reince Priebus, college pals, okay? And Voss looks at states as being the incubator of new ideas. So he is going to make that same call to Reince. give us the opportunity to do this. We want to try this. And I think because of that line of communication exists, Wisconsin could be in play for things that the Republicans want to get done.
Okay, so questions from all of you. Raise your hands and I'll try to reach you with the microphone. Questions, not speech making, please. Let's and if you want to direct a question at a particular panel member, that's fine too. And this is a shy audience. All the way back there, you're going to make me run back. I'm going to work my way back to you. Oh, you're going to come up. But okay, here we go. You're meeting me halfway. See, the country is not as polarized as you think. I'm going to hold the mic.
Hi, I'm Carrie, and my question is about welfare reform and what was announced yesterday. And I know there was some discussion about federal waivers, so maybe you could talk a little bit about how that might impact Wisconsin.
Okay, this is Governor Walker's proposal with the support of Governor Tommy Thompson on changing some welfare rules in Wisconsin. Who wants to take a stab at that one?
Well, I think that it sort of fits under the category with regard to the example I used about drug testing people on food assistance. For Governor Walker to be able to implement some of the plans that he has in his new proposal yesterday, requiring able-bodied parents to work at least 80 hours a month when they're receiving assistance. And also there's something in his proposal about housing assistance as well and some requirements. And as federal laws right now, he would need some waivers to allow those things to be implemented at the state level, and he has a much easier time of pursuing those waivers now. So there will be changes of that type, or whether it's waivers of specific regulations, or whether, you know, back in the 1990s when we reformed welfare, when the federal government reformed welfare and it became more of a block grant system, states do have much more freedom now. One assumes, right, that they will continue to have more freedom, right? Whatever freedom or latitude the Obama administration was offering, I'm sure we can expect that it would go further under the Trump administration.
Anybody else want to weigh in on that?
I think what this was a continuation. Kathleen made an excellent point. This was sort of the logical extension at the state level of the theory of welfare to work from, was that 1995? It was right after the midterms of 94. President Clinton then actually signed off on that. I think what you're seeing is, you're right, there are waivers that it was no coincidence that Governor Walker waited until right after the inauguration to announce this so that the Obama administration couldn't start some procedure to stop this, which probably would have been slapped down by the new Trump administration anyway. But I think Kathleen's absolutely right with the block grant program. You might see a court battle over this, but I think the states have a whole lot of leeway to do this. But I think this is, as you mentioned, Kathleen, the states being sort of the laboratory of democracy, and as Paul mentioned, with Wisconsin really sort of leading the way, especially on the Act 10 reforms with respect to a government's relationship with its workforce and the benefits that it's giving its workforce. I think you might see other states or the Trump administration sort of see how this plays out to get the idea is people working as they're getting their assistance and sort of, I've heard it described as tough love in that respect.
Okay, let's move on to another question.
Oh, thanks. So I marched on Saturday in Milwaukee, and I was very proud at the turnout that we had in River West. And the reason why I marched was because I wanted to be part of the movement to represent to Washington that this administration does not represent me, and I wanted to make sure that they heard that. I don't think that Donald Trump is at all interested in the fact that he doesn't represent me. But I wonder if anybody else in Washington is paying attention. And I wonder about people like Ron Johnson, if he's worried about his seat, Kathy Baldwin, if she needs support to indicate that, you know, there are people out there who are willing to vote for her and see her back in office. You know, is anybody listening to those of us who feel that we aren't represented?
People, believe me, people listen. This was not, when I said earlier, well, you know, we've seen this act before. Remember, at the time, it was pretty phenomenal what was happening here. And we didn't know how it was going to play out. One could argue if the recall law was different, if the vote had happened earlier, who knows what the outcome was. But it's fine. It played out a certain way. So I'll answer your question a couple of different ways. For of course, Trump isn't listening and doesn't care. And I'm not saying he should. You know, he's got his own agenda to do, and he doesn't really care. And, you know,
he cares.
And
he's got a big ego.
I mean, he cares about people voting illegally because he doesn't believe that, you know, he doesn't want people to believe that he didn't really win the election and all that. But let's not go down that rabbit hole. To answer your question more specifically, of course, for someone like Tammy Baldwin, you know, the dynamic we're against, Dan outlined one piece of it, which is usually the out party does better in that first midterm election. But on the other hand, we also know we've had two straight midterm elections where turnout has favored Scott Walker and the Republicans, and Democrats have had sort of that Obama coalition kind of sit home in many ways. And so maybe this is the beginning of something that will have more spillover effect 2 years from now. But the other way they're listening, and I want to get to maybe a more fundamental point here. The Democrats have got to decide what kind of opposition we are going to be. The problem we have, I think, that you guys don't, I liken the Republicans in the Obama years as basically, they're the arsonists who show up when the fire is blazing with the fire trucks and say, oh my God, you need us now, not really caring that the house is burning down. Because basically, they don't care about government. And Mitch McConnell said it from the very beginning, and ultimately became McConnell and Boehner, and then finally Ryan, but certainly McConnell. He said from the very beginning, we want this president to fail, and we're going to do everything possible to stop him. And that's entirely what they did. And look at the outcome. A, they didn't beat Obama. That's a cautionary tale to us. Right? If we think everything has to be anti-Trump, 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 there's no guarantee we're going to get our man in 4 years. But the side effect was extraordinary gains across the board in every other election in the states, in the legislatures, in the governors, the state houses, in the Congress, and ultimately in the Senate. They won everything in the meantime, so it had its power. Democrats have a problem because we don't want to burn the house down. Deep down, we kind of hope government might work and might help people. And so Trump's going to throw a few little bones our way every now and then on infrastructure or a jobs plan or something, trade, which is still dividing our party too in some ways. You know, that can't you work with me on here? And let me just say my own view of this, which is I think about 98.6% of the time, our reaction to that has got to be no damn way. And we have to just fight this guy every possible which way from the very beginning and just be disciplined and tough about it. And from that standpoint, those millions that showed up on Saturday are an important first step. And that's the voice that has to be heard. But it can't be a march, and it can't just be a protest, and it can't be a losing issue that ultimately, no offense to the teachers or people in public employees who I deeply respect, but that issue wasn't the right issue ultimately to carry forward all the way against Scott Walker. We got to find ground that we can fight this guy on and beat him, but be merciless about it. This is no time for Mr. Nice Guy in terms of the Democratic Party. Our entire future's at stake, our country's future's at stake, our world's future's at stake, and the only way to fight this guy is to fight. And he'll never respect us, frankly, if we don't. So from that standpoint, your voices were heard on Saturday.
I think Paul should have been speaking on Saturday. I don't know. I'm like, yeah, let's fight against Trump. Wait, what?
Okay, anybody else want to weigh in on that? Kathleen, you want to?
I mean, just some quickly on that. Tammy Baldwin's going to be the most interesting one because she's up in 2018. You asked about Ron Johnson, just reelected, and he indicated that he's not even running after this. He's done. I'm sure he's going to hold to his word on that. But what's interesting is that some estimates had 75 to 100,000 in Madison marching, you know, and we saw that in 2011 on Act 10. Did things change the way you wanted? And then who is the Democratic bench? Who are the Democratic leaders? I mean, I think I heard President Obama on his way out saying,
I think it's Paul Maslin now.
You know, so they're organizing, yes, they're marching, but who is going to be in the fields that are running at the Common Council, at the state legislature, at the, you know, and who's running for Supreme Court against Ziegler?
Yeah, fair enough.
Okay, here's another question.
So I have to ask a poli-sci question because I haven't had an opportunity since college, and that was a long time ago. You touched on the fact that, Hillary Clinton won the popular vote. Trump won the Electoral College. We're in Wisconsin. many people argue that those flyover states that we have without an electoral college, we really wouldn't play a role in a presidential election. What are your thoughts? Do we keep the electoral college or do we get rid of it?
Well, I think you can make an argument on either side, right? And I think people will come down to, you know, do they see themselves as more traditionalist? I mean, you know, when I talk about the Electoral College with my classes, I say, you know, we want to understand why the Electoral College is part of our system, right? And it's a part of our system for a couple of reasons, one of which was that the framers really wanted some sort of buffer between the people and the direct election of the president, because as a single executive, they were afraid of a king. They were afraid of a poor decision-making made by, you know, the rabble. The Electoral College also has its roots in protecting slavery and protecting the southern states and their representation in an executive branch. So it has a lot of historical roots. It has a purpose. It has a meaning. It has changed dramatically, right? We don't use the Electoral College in the same way that we used to. It is no longer the sort of stopgap, you know, if a flawed candidate was elected by the people, that the Electoral College could step in and save us. We don't use it that way. Structurally, we've changed it enough. On the other hand, we also didn't used to directly elect our U.S. senators until we amended the Constitution at the beginning of the 20th century. And I always say to my classes, you know, we're big boys and girls. We can directly elect our senators. We've handled it for 100 years now. So I think for people, it is a philosophical question about whether you see power, you know, more well placed in the hands of individuals and trusting people to make those choices and following the popular vote, or if you see some benefit to the sort of structural aspects of it, which is to try, you know, at least as we're using it now, to try to represent at least some states. Now, you know, in any presidential election, 35 to maybe 40 of the states are irrelevant because we generally know the outcome in those states ahead of time. And so what we have really come to is an electoral college that focuses on a series of battleground states. As a political scientist, I don't have a position one way or the other. I think there are arguments you could make either way. And for me, it's one of those sort of value questions, right? What do you value most as an outcome, and how would you get there?
Let me just add real quick, Wisconsin turned out to be a flyover state for one party, but not the other. One of my clients is National Popular Vote. I'm not going to bore you with the details except to say that they essentially came to the conclusion a long time ago you'd never get a constitutional amendment to get rid of the Electoral College. So it's a compact between states. There are about a dozen states that have already agreed to this, where essentially the states say at the point at which our numbers reach 270 electoral votes, we then all agree that our votes would automatically go to the winner of the National Popular Vote. So if it ever gets enough steam. But and when I'd go around to people 2 or 3 years ago, Democrats, and say, can't you get interested in this? Can't you get behind it? They'd all talk about Blue Wall and how the Electoral College was our friend. And I kept warning them. I said, you know, that's what the Republicans said in the 80s during Reagan. They thought they had a lock. They called it a lock on the Electoral College. And then all of a sudden, Bill Clinton came along in 1992, and that lock just went nowhere. California was part of their lock. You know, now we're talking about California's, you know, votes that shouldn't even be part. I'm not saying you're saying 3/5, but basically trying to discredit California's role even as a part of the popular vote. That's because it's moved so Democratic. So these things always change. I will sadly point out, whatever the virtues of the political science here, that polls taken since the election show there has been a drop. Want to talk about polarization? There's been a decline of about 30 points or more among Republicans who support the idea of national popular vote since the election. And if I really was going to be mean, I would also point out that there are results, there are polls saying that if you're a Republican and not college educated, 65% of you believe that Trump won the popular vote. So we're in this weird kind of cloud cuckoo land where I don't think, frankly, we're going to have any change to the Electoral College, even though we should.
Okay, other questions? Raise your hand. Okay. I'm coming your way.
You know, while we're...
Oh, you hate dead air time, right, Dan?
Yeah, you gotta...
Right, any radio guy hates dead air time.
Gotta tap dance while we're having time. The ironic thing about amending the Electoral College is that to do so, you do need a constitutional amendment, and the Republicans are actually, in terms of the number of state legislatures they control, I believe it's, 2 or 3 away from actually being able to do that. Now, they're never going to get the 66 senators or whatever it would be, but it's just interesting that at least in the House and in the state legislatures that the Republicans would be the only ones who'd be able to do it, at least at this point.
A lot of social scientists agree that there are about 14 basic hallmarks of fascism. And there are a lot of people that are claiming, liberals and progressives and Democrats are claiming that Donald Trump is following these hallmarks pretty much down the book. And I won't list all of them, but some of the most troubling are, of course, his suppression of the press, attacking women, attacking and scapegoating refugees and minorities, cronyism, and it goes on and on. So my question is, it's extremely troubling to me, and I think a lot of people, basically half of America, that it seems that this president is attacking the very foundations of our democracy. And I'm most troubled by his attack of the press. And so my question to you is, where do we go with this imbalance? And, you know, the founding fathers set this country up in such a way that the press was one of the protectors of our democracy and informed the public. And so it's, where do we go from here?
Okay, Charles, you represent the institutional press.
It's all on my shoulders.
Yeah, absolutely.
The weight of the world. I don't know the complete answer to that question. All I can tell you is that in my experience, I had one chance to interview Donald Trump. It was on his plane. It was with several other reporters. It was his first trip to Wisconsin during the primary. And I have never met a politician who enjoyed tangling, battling, fighting with the media as much as he did. The day we had a chance to talk to him was the day the story broke about Corey Lewandowski, which was his campaign manager at the time, was tagged down in Florida for the assault or the misdemeanor charge. Normally, if you interview any other candidate about a situation like that, the first question about that is going to be their talking point and end of story. He kept bringing it up. Again, and then when we went to the rally afterward, he brought it up again. So he loves having what he calls this running war with the media. And I think what the media is going to be doing is to continue to do their job, ask the questions, find out why these things are happening. I'm not at the national level, I'm only at the local level. And I still think the news media, and my news director is here, Janet Hunley, if you could wave your hand. You know, even at the local level, we know. I mean, today we did a story on what do these executive orders mean? What is this? Now, other presidents have done this. So we are always going to try to find a way to explain what is going on to the best of our ability through people who are either invested in what's happening or impacted on what's happening, and the opportunities. I mean, I've interviewed Reince Priebus since he's been appointed to the chief of staff. I just sat down with Paul Ryan a week ago. We're gonna have access to those folks. Paul Ryan is pretty accessible almost on a daily basis when he's out there. So there will be other ways. But the only prediction I made correctly last year was that this was gonna be an unpredictable, uncharted, unorthodox election. And even Paul Ryan, he said, why do you think, do you think he's going to be an unconventional president? He says, don't you?
Okay, let's get into some more questions here if we can.
Can I just say one thing?
One thing.
Okay. And this is with all due respect to Charles and the Fourth Estate. You know, we do, the media are an incredibly important part of our democracy, but we do have a media that has evolved in a way that is corporate owned and profit and ratings driven. And, you know, Dan himself admitted that what, you know, his role is to entertain people. So I spoke about engagement at first, and I would argue as a political scientist that the media you envision as protecting us doesn't exist in the country right now. But perhaps the contentious relationship between the president and the media will help the media understand. I mean, there are people who would argue to you that CNN gave us President Trump because they were driven by ratings. Every utterance out of his mouth was equally important. He received enormous amounts of free media during the primary, such that he is a media creation, right? I mean, he was a media character first, he was a media creation. The media, right, as we use that term, there are many, many different things, you know, from Woodward and Bernstein, you know, 40 years ago, to Chris Cuomo, right, being on CNN's Good Morning Show. So I think that all aspects of our politics have changed in a way that have brought us here. So I think that there is more than one level of what you're referring to as the media there.
Okay, if the panel, no, that's okay, Paul. I'm just going to explain that we're set to end at 7:30, but the panel is engaged, and so we're going to go a little overtime. So go ahead, Paul.
I'm going to answer the question. It's going to be brief, but the question is a serious enough question that deserves an answer. I was on a panel at UCLA in September, and I shudder to think what I said that day, because this was at a point when we all thought Trump had no chance of winning. But I will say this. One of the panel members was a distinguished elderly professor who had escaped Hungary in the 50s at UCLA, whose specific study was essentially demagogic dictators in the 20th century. We can all think of the two most that come most to mind, but he went beyond those and talked about others, including Silvio Berlusconi, a more recent example in Italy. And when he spoke, and he didn't need to fill in the gaps, folks, he absolutely was going down your road. That audience was rapt with attention. Yes, it was a more lefty crowd because we're in Los Angeles. But I don't mess around with this subject, and I don't trust, with all due respect, I don't trust the media in its current state of weakness. Corporate-owned, diffuse, people barely scraping to earn a living. My daughter's a freelance journalist in Central America, and you know, you would be amazed at the story she tells me of how she has to try to make a living just to have a free press in one part of the world. This guy is dangerous. I hate to say that I root for incompetence here, but that's probably where I am right now, because if he really goes and does what he does, I don't think the F word is wrong at all to start thinking. And go ahead, Dan.
Boy, it's amazing how we could be so polarized as an electorate when the immediate comparison is to Hitler and Mussolini.
I didn't say those words. You did. I said Berlusconi.
This is how you can tell. I
didn't say those words.
To answer the original question, we're protected by a constitution. The issue that you're, and I was actually looking up the 14... things of hallmarks of fascism. It's actually government control of the media. And what was the thing we started talking about? We were all laughing about Sean Spicer talking about alternative facts. If we were in a fascist society or anywhere near there, there would be no laughing at or mocking Dear Leader, okay? I mean, we've got Saturday Night Live, and yes, he gets mad at it. Oh my goodness, he's narcissistic and he doesn't like being made fun of. Personally, if you don't think Alec Baldwin does a spot on Trump, you're insane. I mean, he absolutely nails it. I don't know how to even answer. Could America become fascistic? We're protected by the Constitution, and yes, I'll actually wholeheartedly agree, a weak press, but it's amazing how much stronger and how much more accountable, especially the national press, was going to make the president and the Congress at exactly 12:01 Eastern time on Friday. It's weird how that kind of flipped. I'm just going to leave it there.
Okay, here's another question. Go ahead, sir.
So during the last crazy kind of hectic election year, we saw kind of like all different sides of the political spectrum. You know, saw the populism in Donald Trump. You saw the Tea Party and the traditional candidates on the Republican side, and then you saw the traditional candidate of Hillary, and then you saw the radical Democratic Socialists in Bernie Sanders. So with the way politics kind of went on last year, are we seeing more of like a split into a multi-party system in the country, or is it going to stay pretty much the same way that it's been?
Okay, now there's a real simple question. Try to keep your answers to 10 seconds or less. I'm kidding. Go ahead.
So the short answer is no. the United States is a two-party system for lots of reasons, many of them structural, some of them political. I would argue that certainly Bernie Sanders and Hillary Clinton represented different wings of the Democratic Party, but they were fundamentally different from any of the wings of the Republican Party. And the parties in the United States have been very successful at becoming two relatively broad-based opposing coalitions. They expand when they need to take in somebody. If you're obviously too young to remember Ross Perot from the 1990s. But when Ross Perot ran in 1992, he was sort of staking out this position about the deficit and the size of the debt, and neither of the two parties were talking about that issue there. And then the two parties very smartly said, oh, look, he got 19% of the popular vote. We need to take those people in under our umbrellas. And so the parties, each kind of changed. And President Clinton, elected the first time in 92, concern about the debt and the deficit and things like that. So politically, the two parties, have been very smart about maintaining their bases and their coalitions to a degree. But again, there are all sorts of structural reasons, right, that a two-party system is what fits our electoral system best. We don't have proportional representation. We have single-member districts for Congress and for the vast majority of state legislatures. And so when there are fewer seats at offer, the smaller number of parties who contest, that's sort of the reasonable and most sensible way of contesting candidates. So, there are just lots of different reasons that we're really not moving in any sort of splinter direction.
No, but maybe. That'd be my answer.
Yeah,
I think you never know. You never know these days.
Right. The parties are evolving. They always evolve. Okay, here's a question.
Yeah, so as part of three major target demographics, young, Hispanic, and female, what would you say to someone who did not vote Democratic and gets possibly called the F word and, listen to Madonna say, if you're not on our side, F you? How does that, if I were on the fence, how does that bring me over? I mean, what would you say to me? If you were in my position,
don't listen
what would
to
you
Madonna.
Say?
Yeah, I would say don't take your political views from Madonna.
Papa don't preach, is that the right?
Now grandma don't preach.
So, we have in many ways distilled our politics down to super simplistic things, right? You're a Latina, you're young, you're supposed to be Democratic, and you're not. And that's fine. And as many, many signs told us, right, white women gave us Donald Trump, right, because it was white women who deserted Hillary Clinton. One of the problems that we have in understanding how politics works is that people, don't really, focus sort of correctly on how votes are distributed and which groups are supporting which candidates and how things play out. So if you were not spoken to by the Democratic Party and somebody tells you differently, then you have, hopefully, well-reasoned ideas about why you voted for a Republican or why you voted for a third-party candidate or why you didn't vote for a Democrat. So I think one person does not speak for any party, right? And so I think, as somebody who teaches at a university, it's incumbent upon everybody to understand why they're voting the way that they do. That they should vote, of course, absolutely, always. But that they aren't reflexively voting, because they are a woman or because they are a Democrat or because they're a Republican. That they have reasons that they can articulate. And so when somebody, is hostile back to you, that you have a response for that.
This is why I only get my political philosophy from Ashley Judd. but it is, and this is what I was talking about, and I think Paul touched on with the Walker effect in Wisconsin. It does have that sort of boomerang effect. There was a story about a woman who was going to one of the inaugural balls, And she was just there because a lot of her friends, she had worked in Washington. She was very active in the George W. Bush administration. And she's walking into the ball, and somebody threw an egg at her. And she was writing about this in Politico, I think today or yesterday. And she said, I don't even like Trump all that much. But what that did, I felt myself starting to cry and got angry. And it solidified my resolve to support this president who I don't even really like, because the people who are telling me not to support him are throwing eggs at me. So I think maybe what you're feeling is that same thing. It's sort of that boomerang effect that's just counterproductive.
Yeah. And I would just say, and I can't speak for you, but we can't guilt people. But I would ask you just to look honestly at this administration, the people who are billionaires, white men, the few that aren't. Look at their policies on immigration. Start seeing if there are people you know that are starting to worry about whether they're actually going to be able to stay in the United States or not, or whether they're being singled out because of who they are and what their last name is and what the color of their skin are. Look at issues like reproductive rights. Look at your economic and education capabilities and possibilities. And if you find that this administration is satisfactory in all those things, great. And if you don't, then hopefully, rather than Madonna preaching, my party has real people who aren't just 70 years old. No knock on our previous nominee, but you know, maybe we can jump ahead a generation here, that actually are saying something that you might respond to, and that you might, that offer a real hope and reason to support us, not simply knocking the other guy. But I will guarantee you, and again, I don't know your politics, but I guarantee you there's gonna be ample opportunity for people like you to make a judgment about what this administration really is and who it's really looking out for. And we'll see what the outcome of that is.
Charles, during your reporting this year, did you hear this kind of discussion, I guess, amongst the electorate, where you had two very unpopular candidates, which I think brought out a lot of people's emotions? And so I'm wondering whether, how much of that you heard on the campaign trail.
Well, what you see, at least I was at both conventions, and I only went to Trump rallies because those were the only ones in Wisconsin. I did not get to
boom,
go
rim shot
to Hillary Clinton. And so what was interesting was Donald Trump comes to Eau Claire, Wisconsin towards the end. And it was a small arena was the setting. But outside, the line snaked around for a mile or more, it seemed like. I just couldn't believe it. And there you see people dressed in a certain way, carrying signs in a certain way that say certain things about Hillary Clinton. And so we all know what the chant was at Trump rallies in terms of what they thought about Hillary Clinton. So some of that comes with the turf in political rallies in terms of their views about whether it was President Bush at the time or Hillary Clinton or even Donald Trump. And then there was a small group of folks who had shown up at that same Trump rally who were there in support of Hillary Clinton and doing their chant, love Trump's hate was one of them. And so, you see it, it's there. It sometimes becomes part of the narrative, but not all of the narrative.
Okay, here's our last question. Go ahead, Kevin.
I'm last, great. Hi, I'll try to. I'm wondering, obviously, there was a great article yesterday in Politico. It focused on Pepin County and what happened there. Just to kind of rehash what the article was about, basically Pepin County, pretty much I believe since Nixon McGovern had been a Democratic county, and suddenly, lo and behold, in 2016, it goes like 62% for Trump. The moral kind of point of the article is basically how Trump had tapped into the cultural differences and how the Democratic Party has kind of become this clearinghouse of elites, and I say this inside of college, so God help me, but where you're kind of college-educated. Did I hit something? Okay, college-educated individual looks down on kind of a guy who busts his butt, 9 to 5, working at a factory, and you're seeing that lifestyle. I'm from the Sheboygan area, so for me, and Paul may know these numbers better than I might. Once upon a time, those were reliable Democratic counties. Now they are ruby red. And you're seeing that now expand. Sorry. basically, the point of my question is, are Democrats to the point, and this is a, and you're seeing this in the rural areas, where you're literally candidates cannot even go into a union hall and talk gun control or immigration because chances are they might be more siding with somebody like Donald Trump, I'd say, than, you know, Hillary Clinton and so on and so forth.
Yeah, I mean, there's a bunch in that, of things in that statement, but let me just say, because I could not agree more with your with that story and with the analysis. One of the saddest legacies of a man who I do think was a decent, honest, inspiring at times, and effective in many ways president, though, is the fact that this part of America turned on his party, and he was not without responsibility for that. I do think that this was not simply economic, that a lot of it was cultural, and I think essentially a group of voters, you know, basically said, you all think, you all in Madison and Washington and L.A. and Chicago and the Upper East Side of New York, or Upper West Side of New York, actually, more accurately, you all think that you're better and smarter than us, and we're going to show you. And they did. Now, whether how much of that has roots in policy, and you name a couple that are problematic for us, clearly as a party, and how much of it is more, you know, sort of in the, you know, in sort of the rhythm and passion of what people feel and the way they feel about their lives and the way that people feel about around them, I can't quantify yet. But if our answer is simply to trot out more of the same, including Madonna, and to essentially say, don't you get it, you stupid Americans? And, oh, by the way, we're not going to change course at all, and we don't really care about you. There are people in my party who are arguing now, screw the working class of Michigan and Pennsylvania and Ohio, because they're gone forever. Maybe in 20 years they'll be proved to be correct and there will be this great demographic destiny and Texas will be a Democratic state. And I'm not joking. I mean, that possibly could happen. But guess what? We're gonna suffer an awful lot in the meantime. And so I couldn't agree, and I know you're not coming from the same partisan perspective that I am, but I couldn't agree more with the diagnosis, and it is a big-time problem and concern for Democrats. And if we don't understand that, we're going to be looking at some more negative election returns in 2018, 2019.
Okay, let's do some parting. We're going to do parting words. Everybody's going to get their say here, and this will conclude. So whoever wants to answer that question and give some parting words, go ahead.
Well, all I was going to say is, and let's remember, Hillary Clinton won the popular vote by 3 million votes. So, I mean, it's the aggregation of some votes in some areas, and I'm not disputing anything you say, but I think that what we have trafficked in politics for a long time is in stereotypes, and I think there are lots of Democrats and lots of Democratic candidates and lots of Democratic office holders who don't look down their nose and don't hold those stereotypes about, you know, the other. So I think that that's part of the emotional nature of this election and the kind of cultural versus the economic. But I also think that we shouldn't lose sight of the fact that Hillary Clinton won 3 million more votes than did Donald Trump.
Yeah, but ran a stupid campaign that lost the Electoral College. And, by the way, we don't have the governor of Wisconsin. We don't have the legislature in Wisconsin.
Absolutely.
We don't have most of the I did the 8th district race. Tom Nelson, very good guy, got blown away in this election. So you're right, but just to the Democrats in the room, at some point, it doesn't matter anymore that she won 3 million more votes, because we have real live difficulties and problems and things that we have to try to work out. And if we just hang our hat on that, we're going to be in a sad, sad situation.
And if the party overcorrects too dramatically, it's not going to be any better.
I wanted to add to Kevin's question, and what was perfectly explained what happened. It wasn't a demographic shift. It wasn't a political shift. It was a cultural shift. The single best piece of analysis of the 2016 election was written a couple of weeks before. And because this was 2016, it was from cracked.com, which is a humor website. And it drew parallels to what a lot of people were feeling to the movies we watch. And the most prominent example was given was The Hunger Games. If anybody has read the book or watched the movies, the heroin is from like a coal mining district where children are forced to fight to the death for the amusement of these people who have weird customs, who live in the cities. And it was like the underdog story finally rising up against the wickedness of the cities. The author brilliantly showed how, as Michael Moore famously said in his movie Trumplandia or Trump World or whatever he called it, this is going to be the biggest bleep you, the biggest middle finger in the history of civilization. Just like I mentioned Brexit before it, people saying that not only are politicians looking down their noses at us, Hollywood, the national media is not representative of what we understand America to be. Rightly or wrongly, this is a sense that was so widespread, it was underestimated everywhere, and it led directly to Trump's election. Now, a big part of Trump's election was the fact that it's very difficult for a political party to hold on to the presidency for three straight cycles. It just is, all right? The last time it happened, what did we say? George H.W. Bush and Harry Truman, and that's pretty much it in the last 100 years. It's just, it doesn't happen very often. But a big part of it was you've got a big segment of people, and a lot of them, I'm guessing, are in Pepin County, that for many years have felt like, well, these people don't care about me. They care about what's going on in the big cities. They care about what's going on in their world. They can't even speak my language. We're so diametrically opposite in our worldview that they just don't relate to me anymore. It was something to me, it was almost primal. It was not a resentment, but a recognition that those in power politically are just different from those out of power. And Donald Trump was the human middle finger for those out of power. I mean, that's what he was. We underestimated it in the Republican primary, and we underestimated it in the general election too.
Okay, Charles, that's an easy way to end this. Go ahead.
So I like to finish on trying to wave the flag again for the media and not a white flag. I think it's fascinating the times that we live in. And I would ask you, do any of you remember a big story that was broken during the campaign, what it might have been? Someone shout something out at me.
Russia.
The Russian story. I'm talking about during the campaign. Emails.
All right. Billy Bush.
Billy Bush.
So the Billy Bush story, that was broken by the Washington Post, by a reporter who also broke a lot of stories about Trump's foundation. Pew Research just did a recent survey about where people get their news from. The Washington Post isn't even on the list. How many people watched Fox News as their number one source for presidential politics?
This is not a right-wing crowd.
You have some 40% of you, then you have something in common with 40% of Trump supporters. Only 3% of Clinton supporters watch Fox News. My point on that is, while the media may be doing a lot of big stories and providing a lot of big information and holding candidates accountable, what they can't control is how you watch it and how you consume it. And I'll tell you something that was fascinating to me that happened. When I interviewed Donald Trump, I had a microphone in my left hand and I had a cell phone in my right hand. In the cell phone was Facebook Live. I carried that news conference for 20 minutes with Donald Trump on the plane. I was about as close to him as you. And I asked him a lot of tough questions about Governor Walker, about Paul Ryan, and about his style of politics in Wisconsin. During that 20 minutes, 36,000 people on Facebook watched that interview. One rating point in Milwaukee is 9,000 households. During that 20 minutes, we got a 4 rating. That's some newscasts that we do. 2,000 people were engaged in that conversation because they reacted immediately to what was said and what they thought. In this Pew Research, Facebook is number 3 in what voters use to choose how they watched politics. And guess what? Thank God local TV was fourth.
But I got to say, though, but it was Facebook that now agrees that they were basically part of a system where fake news was just thrown out there time and time and time again. And hats off, by the way, that guy stupidly gave his story to the New York Times, and so he lost his job, the Maryland delegate. Who this guy was working for now in Maryland, Republican, fired him because he didn't want to have a guy who realized he invented the entire story about the Ohio ballots and Hillary Clinton and admitted it after the fact. But the truth is, I mean, Mark Zuckerberg can say all he wants. And I understand, Charles, what you're saying. And if I felt better about our democracy, I'd say, isn't it great?
But
it can be manipulated. It can be manipulated by the lowest common denominator. And I don't see any controls. And here we go.
The controls are, and that's where I think local media, national media, people who have been covering it for years, you have to choose where you're going to have your credibility. And I think, and I know, I work on my credibility every day, so what I am reporting is the truth. The other key point I will make is that twice a week, three times a week actually, we fact check what the politicians say. And we put it out on social media, on Twitter. And guess how many times those stories get retweeted? Not a lot. It's the one area where we are working constantly in partnership with the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel. The Washington Post does this. And so I say the media is keeping an eye, is trying to do its best in finding out where the truth is and holding them all accountable.
Aren't you glad we're talking about the media instead of polling, Paul? Okay, anyway, anybody else have anything to say? Okay, look, the hour of 7:30 having arrived, I think we're going to close it down now. But thank you very much. I want to thank our panelists, Charles Benson, Professor Kathleen Dolan, Paul Maslin, and Dan O'Donnell of WISN. I want to thank our sponsors, UW-Milwaukee, and the staff who helped put on this great event, the Firm Consulting, Milwaukee Police Association, 1125 of PAPS, and the Medical College of Wisconsin. We'll be doing also an event in February. Come to WisPolitics.com. You can see details of that. Thanks, everybody. And you can watch this if you want to. You can watch it later on Wisconsin Eye. It's going to be Wisconsin Eye was here videotaping it, and you'll be able to see that on Wisconsin Eye. And send a link to your friends if you like. Thank you.